And now.
And now, introducing the one, the only.
Let me introduce to you.
Lively talk with successful people, barely filtered. This is the Jenna Ben Show.
All right. With us today, we have Mikey Z. Now, Mikey, welcome. We've known each other for a minute. Introduce yourself. Tell us where you're from, how old you are, where you live now, what you do for a living.
All right. My name is Michael Zelix-Kovics. I am 46 now, from New Jersey. Lived there until, 2008, then moved out to Vegas. I'm still in Vegas now. I've worked as creative lead in hospitality in Vegas since I got here for nightlife groups like the Light Group and then Hakkasan Group. And for the past 2 years, I was as digital creative director for MGM Resorts, until all the COVID stuff happened. And I'm in the middle of kind of launching my own creative agency at the moment.
Okay. Hey, I didn't know about that last part. Congrats.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. So you are married. You found your person, but we are here today to talk about your dating horror stories prior to you finding the one. And I know you have a few.
So this was let me set it up for you. So it's the year 2000 summer. It's right around 4th of July. So we made it out of Y2K, and it was, I guess the only thing you thought of when you heard the word 9/11 was a Porsche, right? So we're in between those two events. I was working as a waiter at a restaurant called Luca's in Edison, New Jersey. And I ran like a promotional team for nightlife events in New York, New Jersey. And this new girl started working with us at Luca's at the restaurant, and I was really attracted to her. So I finally got up the courage to ask her out on a date, and she said, yeah. And I was like, all right, well, I'll take you out in the city. We're going to go to New York to one of the clubs. I forget the name. Really hot spot at the time. We got into the city pretty quickly without a problem. We went into the nightclub. We got walked in, taken care of. So I was adding points before we got there, you know. It worked out really well. And before you know it, we're like, making out on the dance floor. It was like great. It was great. And I was like, wow, it was like the perfect date. Everything went amazing. Sunday comes around. I walk into Luca's where we both work, and I'm walking, like I float in, you know, cause I'm on cloud nine. I can't wait to see her. And a girl, one of the other waitresses runs up to me, and she's like, oh my God, did you hear what happened to Elizabeth? Her name was Elizabeth. Is Elizabeth. She's not that.
God.
I'm like, yeah. And I'm like, no, and in my mind, you know, I'm such a wisest back then. I'm like, oh, yes, you had an amazing date. Is that what you're, you know, I figured that's what she's talking about. And she's like, she got hit by lightning. And I'm like, what? And she's like, she was in Princeton at the school thing at Princeton College. She was walking and it was raining. She went underneath the tree and she got hit by lightning. That's all they know. So I'm like, it was surreal. It's kind of surreal. You don't think you'd ever hear anything that like that in your life.
So
I'm like, okay. I'm like, listen, get me her mother's number. I don't have her mom's number. And her mom was really nice. Her mom was like, oh, you know, I know who you are. She said she had a really great time. She was walking on the street in Princeton. It started raining. She went underneath the tree. Lightning hit the tree, bounced off the tree, went in her shoulder and came out her foot. So she was, her hair caught on fire, everything. She was on the ground unconscious. And the only reason she's alive is because there was a doctor like jogging by at the time, and he came over and put her out and gave her CPR, brought her back. She's in a coma. So her mom's like, she's in a coma right now at the hospital. And I'm like right now I feel like chills because I'm even thinking back. So I'm like, oh, that's so crazy. And I'm like, oh my goodness, you know, oh my God. So I'm like, okay, well, there's nothing I could do, but please let me know, keep me informed of what's happening. We're all worried about her. So a few days go by, and she was in a coma for, I think, like 3 days. So her mom calls me up. She's doing a little better. She's out of a coma, but she has no memory. She has no idea who you are. She doesn't know Luca's. She just kind of knows a little bit. She's slowly starting to come back to her. So I'm like, okay, well, you know, still just keep me updated.
Yeah.
So then like another week later goes by, and she's like, you know, they moved to a different facility. She's starting to do rehab. She remembers me. She doesn't remember details. She remembers Luca's. She's like, I think it might be a good time for you to come visit. And I have no idea what to expect. I sent her flowers. And this was the year 2000. Guido was still a thing. So I had I was working out a lot more. I had a skin tight Armani Exchange t-shirt on. I looked like a total idiot. Spiked up hair, the blowout, you know, total idiot. And I walk in the hospital, and the nurse walks me back around, and there in the room is Elizabeth. She's really bad. Like, her head is completely in a bandage. She can't walk. She's in the middle of therapy when I walk up, and they're like teaching her just to like move her arms and stuff. And I'm like, oh my God, this is like, I shouldn't be here. Like, I'm not immediate family. Yeah. But the other thing I notice is there's a guy there. So I walk around and I say, hi, I'm like, hi, I'm, I don't remember his name. Hi, I'm whatever. I'm her boyfriend.
So I'm like, what?
What? So he was in Spain in school on some trip, and they've been going together for like 2-3 years. I had no idea. So I'm like, and she doesn't really know me yet. So she doesn't probably know that we hooked up. So I'm like, and my flowers are sitting there from me, you know? And I'm like, this is so awkward. It wasn't intimidating at all. I was probably intimidating to him at the time, but it was just super awkward. And I'm like thinking, I'm like, man, her mom knows. Like, her mom.
What the hell?
So, yeah, gave me some whatever. So I stayed there for like a half hour, but she was going through therapy. And I was like, you know, listen, let me let you guys get back to your thing. I'll call and check up. And I take off. Super weird. But then a few days go by and her mom calls me back and she's like, yeah, you know, she remembers more. She wants to see you. So I'm thinking, all right, maybe it's her boyfriend, but maybe she was on the outs with the guy, you know, and she just didn't tell him. He's in Spain. She figured I'll tell him whenever. So I'm like, all right, round two, you know, let me go back. So I go back to visit and he's there again. He's there while I'm there. And it's, again, super awkward. God. Yeah. And I'm like, it's super awkward. And I'm just like, all right, whatever. I'm like, and this time he walks me out and I'm like, oh God, what's this guy going to say? So as he's walking out, he goes, here's my number. He goes, next time, he goes, just call me and I'll you can meet up with me. Basically saying like, dude, kind of, I think he's saying like I'm the, you know, her man, like step off kind of like in a really nice way, like, hey, call me instead. Like, and I was like, I was really respectful. I'm like, all right, cool. And I was like, screw, you know, that's it. She's got a long way to go. He's there for her. I don't want to be, you know, some weird interference. You know, I think it's best that I just stand back. And her mom didn't really reach out to me anymore. A few months go by and she comes into work. I guess she's up walking and better. And she had to come in, I guess, to get a check, her last check from Lucas, the restaurant. And I was coming in to start my shift at the time. And she looked so different. It was so weird. But, you know, but she was back, you know, she was doing well. And she was really cordial with me and like, hey, how you doing? And I'm like, hey, you know, how you doing? And by this time I already had a new girlfriend. So I was already dating somebody else. Yeah. Like a lot of dating. So I was already dating somebody else, but it wasn't awkward. It was just super cordial. And I was like, all right, that was kind of weird, but I'm glad she's doing well. Good to see she's here. She was there with a friend. She was talking to a bunch of people from work. You know, I let it alone, you know? So then maybe like, a couple weeks later, I'm on AOL Instant Messenger. That's how long ago this was. And she's on there. So I'm like, oh, let me say hi, see how she's doing. And I message her. I forget what I said, just a hello. And she's like, I really would rather not speak with you. I'm really upset with you. And I'm like, why? What? And she's like, you left me and stopped calling and everything because I was like hurt in the hospital. I'm like, no. She's like, because I was, you know, all, you know, screwed up from all that. I'm like, no. I'm like, I stopped talking to you because your boyfriend was there every time I went and made it super uncomfortable for me. I'm like, are you kidding me? So that was basically the last time we talked. But that was really one of my weirdest, like a great, amazing date that went great. And then that just turned into a complete shit show the next day.
Hold on, back up a second. When you called her out and you're like, no, dude, the reason I stopped showing up is because your boyfriend told me to stop coming, basically. What'd she say?
She just acted super defensive and she said, no, that's not it. It's because she goes, and she would kind of just cut me off and just would stop talking and not answer, like, I guess, ghosting now. And I'm like, what? That how it was so not the truth at all in any way, shape, or form. And I couldn't believe that she would even say it. I was kind of like taken back, like, are you, like, take some accountability. You had a boyfriend. She didn't even acknowledge that fact. She just skipped right over that. I was like, no, the reason you were, it was because I was injured and I was hurt and you didn't want to date me. I was like, we went on a first date, you know? So it was, that was probably the craziest.
Dude, I'm tripping on the mom too. Like, how is the mom going to keep...
She could have given me, you know, a little heads up. Like, listen, she's dating a guy for a year, they're on the outs, or she's dating a guy for a year, but she wants, you know, she wants you, just give me some insight. She know, maybe she, I don't know, maybe she didn't know you went on a date. I don't know. I would assume she knew. I sent flowers.
Maybe the mom wanted like she was desperate to just get her daughter back to good health. So any memory that could jog her.
I'll tell you one thing. When I was there, it didn't help anything. There was no, like, she didn't perk up when I was there. It was just kind of like super awkward.
Oh my God. Hey, I would die half an hour.
And
in
I'm
that.
Like, oh my. It was rough. Yeah. It was really rough. It was only, it just felt like such an outsider, you know? And I felt like she was in such a, you know, we only knew each other for such a short period. I felt she was in such a private moment there. And I felt so like I didn't deserve to be there. It was just super awkward. You know, I tried. I felt, you know, she could have, I was really taken aback that she blamed me. You know, I was like, come on.
Totally. Whatever. Yeah. But she suffered enough. So we're not going to bash her too much. So,
yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah,
all right. Exactly. Roll us into the next story.
So number two. So this one takes place in a Jersey Shore. This is, I think, 2005. So I went out on a first date with a girl who's kind of friends of friends, who I thought was really attractive. Again, she was really cool. We went out on a first date just for a small dinner. It went really well. She lived down the shore by, I think, in Deal, in Toms River, or Deal in New Jersey. So the next weekend, she's like, listen, I'm going to be down at Jenkinson's at Point Pleasant Beach in New Jersey with my sister and my friends. Why don't you come meet me down there? We'll spend the day at the shore. Finally got down there. Started walking around, couldn't get her on her phone. She even told me, she's like, listen, I don't have any service. You'll find me on the beach in front of Jenkinson's. Obviously she's not answering. I go down to the beach and start looking for her, and I can't find her. And then I turn around and she's running up to me, like at that moment, jumps at me, gives me this big hug and just starts making out with me. She was just in her bikini, and I was like, okay. So immediately I'm like, all right, this is great. And then I'm like, the first date didn't go that good. This is like weird. She was like making out with me like gratuitously in the middle of this place. So when we stopped kissing, I kind of noticed she's hammered. She is just hammered, annihilated, like ridiculously annihilated. And I'm like, it's like 10 o'clock in the morning.
No.
So I'm like, what? And then we've all had those days where we've day drank and it's gotten a little ahead, but 10, that's a little early. So she eventually tells me she hasn't slept. So I'm like, what am I going to do? And Jenkins has a whole food court. So I'm like, listen, why don't we go grab something to eat? And she's like, yeah, yeah. So we go to eat, and I think she got like a chicken Caesar salad. And she starts eating, and she's doing like the drunk eat where it's like falling out of her mouth. And it's really, really bad. And in the middle of this, she realizes how drunk she is and how she looks. And she's like, oh my God. She starts crying. She's like, I'm so sorry. I'm so embarrassed. And I'm like, no, it happens to all of us. I'm trying to be real. I'm like, I was really like, yeah, but I was like, being nice, like, no, it's fine, whatever. And she's like, no. And she starts getting really dramatic. And she's like, oh, I'm so embarrassed. And she gets up to leave. And I went to grab her hand. I'm like, you know what? Let me let her go back to her sister, back to her friends. This is too much. You know, like I don't even know what to do right now. I tried the food thing. It's not working. So let me let her go. So I call my friend. They're like, we're just hanging out at home, smoking some weed, playing video games. So I'm like, all right, I'm just going to do that. I go back up. You know, it's only an hour back from not fighting traffic. So we're in Edison, just hanging out, drinking beers, smoking weed, and playing video games. And her sister calls me. This is like 3 hours later. And she's like, hey, where are you guys? And I go, what do you mean, where are you guys? And she's like, yeah, where are you and Danielle? And I'm like, I don't know. I don't know where. I'm home. I'm in Edison. I'm like, I've been here for like 3 hours. She's like, what do you mean? I'm like, she was annihilated and she took off. I figured she went back with you. She's like, we haven't seen her. She's like, oh my God, I'll call you back. So I'm like, oh my God. And she's like, she was only in her bikini. She has no sneakers. She has no shoes. She has no pocketbook. She has no phone, nothing.
Wait, so you let her go like without handing her off?
Yes. So that was bad, definitely bad move, but it's a place, if you knew Jenkinson's, it's middle of the day. It's a place where all of her friends are. And I figured she's going back to her sister. So, she calls me back like a half hour later. We still can't find her. We're going to call like the hospitals and everything. And I'm like, okay. And I'm like, well, let me know if you want me to come down and help start looking. So now I'm thinking, holy shit, like she might be dead underneath the the boardwalk or something. And I'm like, how's this going to look on Dateline if I at least go back and try and help?
Oh my God.
Like, I can't. Well, and the guy on the date was up there playing video. I was like, so I'm sitting there and we're stoned. We're contemplating all this. So half hour goes back and her sister calls me. We found her. And I'm like, oh my God, thank God. Is she okay? Well, she's okay, but she's not okay. And I'm like, what do you mean? The police found her. I'm like, well, what do you mean? I'm like, well, when she left you, she walked out and she walked into the parking lot, into the valet, and just hopped into a Range Rover, brand new, and just started up and drove it out of the valet.
Oh, I guess, my
thinking
God.
She was so drunk, thinking it was her own car, and just drove it home. And got into like a police chase. She like crashed the car. They had to like pull her out and arrest her, take her to jail. And I'm like, oh my God. So she like, maybe like a day or two later, she calls me and I'm like, hey, you know, how are you doing?
Not knowing what to expect.
Like, not, yeah, like, and I'm still not, I don't know. I wasn't really, so apparently this girl liked to drink a lot. I didn't know that. And I'm not really taking the accountability. So I'm still thinking, hey, maybe we'll like go out again or something.
Oh my
so
God.
I'm like, all right, well, yeah. Like I'm a total idiot at this time in my life. So I'm like I said, we're smoking weed all day. So I'm like, all right, well, like, you know, I'll talk to you like whatever, you know, maybe later. And she's like, yeah, I don't know if that's a great idea. So I did send her flowers, but I don't think that went over really well. We didn't ever go out on another date again. Yeah.
Wow. All right. You have lived. You've had some fun. You've had some strange things happen to you, but you know what? You married your one.
I've had 30 years of dating experience, and I think I finally found the right one. She's really amazing to me and my son. We couldn't be more happy to have her. She's amazing. She really is.
I love it. And so what advice would you have? What wisdom do you have to pass on to the rest of us single folks who are just trying to find our person?
Well, I tell this to a lot of my ex-girlfriends, and a lot of people, a lot of times, just when they get in a bad relationship, they just have to take this big break and a big pause and they don't go into dating. And next thing you know, they're single for 5-6 years. And you kind of get into a mode where it's really hard to open your life up to bring somebody new into your life after that period. My wife now was that type of situation. So what I tell all of them is you got to keep trying. Next man up. I have the next man up mentality. If the relationship doesn't work, listen, I know that people say they're soulmates, but there's got to be at least 100 soulmates for every one person. There's so many people on this planet. So you just got to keep looking. You just got to keep looking, yeah, and keep plowing ahead until you find the right one. That's my mentality. My first girlfriend, my first love, and my first wife all cheated on me, you know? So I've been in very jaded parts of my life, but I never let it hold me back from being still believing in romance and all that crap. You know, so I just kept moving forward and it worked out for me. And even if it doesn't work out, you know, I know a lot of people get so pulled back from falling in love and then getting hurt or whatever. You know, just all that, the emotions of falling in love, it's a great part. You know, being in love is like what, probably one of the best parts of life, probably. You know, and even if you fail at that a bunch of times, just going through that whole roller coaster of emotions, I don't know, it gives you life, man.
Well said, Mikey. All right, Mikey, cool. We are out of time. Give us your Instagram handle so people know how to find you.
I am at justmikez, so it's just.mike.z.
Okay. Thank you for coming on. Great sort of catching up with you. And I'll holler the next time I make it to Vegas.
Thank you very much. And congrats with the podcast and everything. You're doing a great job. Really proud of you.